want you to look at this game, and really look at it, because it's going to show up in a lot of videos from here on out. Note the price, note what console it's for, and then realize it's a port. They haven't done anything to it. In fact, as far as I can tell, they haven't actually altered it. It's the exact same game put on a similar disc as its original release and placed with a new label saying, oh, it can be played on the Xbox 360. It can be played on the Xbox One. And very likely, it will soon have a label that says it can be played on the Xbox Series X. Why? Because it's a really well-selling game, and it hasn't gone down in price in several years. I can prove it too. I took this picture in 2017. For example, here's Watch Dogs, released for the PS4, so you know around the time that it was released. There it is for the 360. And of course, here it is for the PS3. But even better, there it is for the PS2 in a compilation album. That compilation album stopped selling in 2018. Even in our modern era, it still sells for about $20. In other words, it's kept at its price for longer than the console it was originally released for, and is expected to continue doing that for a very long time, even into the next consoles and the consoles after that, at the same price for the same reasons. I'm not trying to say that this game is perfect, or that I should laud it, or even whether or not it's a good game. Instead, I want to show that it has a high and long-lasting value. I find this shocking because the vast majority of the games I own went down in price really, really fast. For example, these PS4 games, almost all of them were under $20, and many of them were brand new. I'm not trying to show off. What I want to show is that some games, many of which are considered great games for that console, are losing value really, really fast. And it's got me concerned. When I can find Uncharted 1, 2, and 3, each one for a dollar, something's wrong. And then I can do the exact same thing with the Batman series for the PS3. Yeah, there is a pattern. I first really noticed this phenomena when I saw Max Payne 3 a few months after its release for $5 at a GameStop. Imagine finding Doom Eternal just 2 months after its release for $34. About half of what it originally sold. There is some explanation for this. Let's take Super Mario Bros. 3, for example, and put it into pricecharting.com. As you can see, near the beginning, it just cost around $8, $9. But as people got older, it got up, went up in price, its highest being somewhere around $20.41, and that's just the cartridge. So this game sells really well because people suddenly have this sense of nostalgia for it. But beforehand, they really didn't. And you could buy it for $5, maybe $10 pretty easily. So that sense of nostalgia has to kick in years later. Until then, a lot of games just don't sell very well. There's also a long tail of losing value after that. Let's use Fatal Fury for the Neo Geo as an example. Here it is in 2016, $24.99. At its height, $85. But then it loses value and just stays around $30 to $25 after that. So nostalgia pricing does in fact change pricing. However, this doesn't answer the question on why San Andreas can sell consistently for $20 for over a decade. You will note that it is kept at the $20 range almost this entire time. A little blip over in 30 in January, but other than that, around $20. It can't be a collector's item, because collector's items have a sudden precipice or a giant jump to show how much it costs, and it doesn't have the precipice or the drop that would show nostalgia making a growth. I've only seen sales numbers like this for New Super Mario Bros. For the Nintendo DS, where the game consistently sold, brand new, at Best Buy for about $35. The only conclusion I can make is that the companies that make games only value their games for about 3 months after it's been released. Then, they kind of let it drop. They don't want to see it anymore. This makes sense because Sony is a major competitor, and it happens to be a music company, an electronics company, a movie company, and many other companies that have a release and then drop in 3 months type strategy. And this works, because most movies release really big and then slowly teeter off, because few movies are worth seeing again. You see it once, then you never see it again in the theaters. In fact, I can think of very few movies that I personally have gone to see more than once. However, the movies I did see in the theaters more than once, I remember really well. For example, Into the Spider-Verse, one of my favorite movies. Episode 1 of Star Wars was so good to me, I saw it 14 times in the theater. I only paid 4. All the other times, people just kept me around so that I would tell them Star Wars stuff while watching the movie. The movie Titanic was considered a phenomenon because it stayed in the theaters for months and continued to sell because people wanted to see it in the theaters over and over again. However, this isn't true for all movies. Now I have a question for you. It's going to be a hard one. How many times have you seen Infinity Wars in the theaters? Most likely, you've only seen it once. You bought the video, you saw it again, and then you haven't seen it since, and it's okay. Now let me ask you another question. How many times have you seen a Marvel movie in the theaters? Was it only once? These are considered major cultural phenomenons, and yet you only see it once, maybe twice, in the theaters. Therefore, it comes as no surprise that Sony has promoted the idea that their games need to sell for about $70 for the new PS5. They don't think their games are going to sell well enough, but the initial run will have a lot of people with a lot of money spending enough money that they will make a profit, and then let the price plummet because nobody is buying it after that. And I'll go get it for, oh, I don't know, $2, $5, whatever I feel like. However, during the 3DS sales, Satoru Iwata discovered that if a game sold consistently after its release, it would actually raise console sales up, and they would actually have better sales using that method. He didn't really know what to do with it, but he knew it really helped. Speaking of which, I want you to look at these games once more. A lot of these games are still being sold in Walmart right now, even though the 3DS has been discontinued. He later altered that term to long-tail sales, where something has an initial large sale and then a continuous good sale afterwards. The movie Princess Bride is a lot like this. It sold fairly well in the theaters, but it continued to sell afterwards, and more fans and more fans continued to watch it, buy the tapes, buy memorabilia. It has a larger fan base now than it did when it originally released. This is a consistent building up of a long tail. It was evergreen. We still love this movie, even though it's been out of theaters for decades. Nintendo has used this to their advantage. For example, the NES Classic Edition is based on those concepts, and it actually surprised even them at how well it sold. They also make sure to release a game for each series to every single new console so that they can have those consistent long-tail numbers. Super Smash Bros. is a great example of this. They show all the nostalgia, all the great games that everyone loves, and then that sells the other games that they want to sell. There will also be a re-release of many games that have been popular over the years. So the 3D Mario All-Stars makes sense as a compilation album for the Nintendo Switch. Sony and Microsoft, on the other hand, believe that new graphics, new styles for an old game are how you make the game new again, how you sell it a little bit better. It's unknown which one is really going to work, and Sony definitely has compilation albums as well. But you can see kind of the difference between the two groups when you see how they make re-releases. It's not that Sony doesn't have a bunch of games that would be a lot of fun combined or continued. It's that they often don't value those games as important, so when they try to do the same things as Nintendo, they don't do as well. Honestly, the term long tail or evergreen is hard to predict. Let's say you like books from the 1930s. You've probably read a few H.P. Lovecraft, some Sherlock Holmes, stuff like that. And you go, yeah, they were really good during this era. You're wrong, though. You're only reading the good ones. Let's take Shakespeare. You've probably heard of Hamlet, which you're seeing right here. You've heard of Macbeth. You've heard of Midsummer Night's Dream. You've heard of Romeo and Juliet. But have you read all of his sonnets? Have you read all of his comedies? What about all of his tragedies? No? Well, yeah, it makes sense. You've heard about the good ones, and you just assume all the others were just as good. They're not. They're still enjoyable. But they're nowhere near as good as the ones everybody references. Because of this, we have a really difficult time figuring out why movies sell, why books sell, why video games continue to sell decades after the console it was sold for is gone. So why is Grand Theft Auto San Andreas so popular even after all these years? Well, first off, we have to understand the long tail. It's where a game continues to sell even after the initial time. Most companies base all of their game sales on the first 3 months of the game, and then they don't care. The price of the game drops, and everything just kind of disappears. A few of the game makers have realized that if they have a consistent game, they have better sales all around. So they've worked to make their games more perennial, more evergreen, have a long tail. And then we have games like this one, where they weren't trying for this, but it seems to keep on going. So the question is, why? Well, for the next video, I'm going to analyze how this is possible. What is making this game work? What is Sony screwing up? What is Nintendo screwing up? But that's for the next video. Right now, though, I'd like you to click like, check out some of my other stuff like Instagram, and, you know, subscribe. If you like this, share it with others. I honestly don't get a lot of views, and I'd like to really build it up. So if you have some time, send it out. And if you have some ideas and thoughts on why Grand Theft Auto works, tell me. I'd love to see your comments. Have a good one.